Right, everybody, good evening, and welcome to the most recent in our series of LSE debating law public discussion. And it's a huge pleasure for me to introduce Professor Christoph Möllers this evening, who's speaking to his paper on the Acratic Union about democratic weakness of the will in the EU and its member states. And I'm particularly looking forward to this because I've had the pleasure of reading the paper in advance, and I also had the great pleasure of being on a panel with Professor Möllers about a year and a half ago on banking union. And we had a lot of financial regulation lawyers, including myself, throwing around concepts like legitimacy and accountability. And I think you very effectively brought us back to what, as a public lawyer, these concepts actually mean and why they're so important. So Professor Möllers is going to speak to his paper, which really challenges this notion of when we make the EU responsible, what do we mean? And when we target institutions in crisis, who and why are we targeting certain institutions, and should we be doing so? Some very, very big issues to discuss this evening. Professor Möllers is a professor of public and public law and jurisprudence at the Humboldt University in Berlin. He has a whole array of garlands and distinctions, including being a fellow at the NYU School of Law and at the Institute of Advanced Study in Berlin. He's a member of the Berlin-Brandenburg Academy of Sciences and was a judge. I think, probably unlike a lot of us here, he has seen law in action and was a judge at the Superior Administrative Court in Berlin and is one of Europe's leading thinkers in the area of public law and the EU. So Professor Möllers will speak for 40, 45 minutes or so, and the response to the paper will be by Dr. Jan Komárek, who I'll introduce separately, but he's a member of the LSE Law Department, following which we have some time for discussions and comment. So can I encourage you to tweet if that's your thing? So our hashtag is @LSEMöllers, M-O-L-L-E-R-S. And also to remind everybody, this is being recorded for an LSE podcast. And just before I hand over to Professor Möllers, a short shout out for the next lecture in this series, which is our own Professor Conor Geraghty running a session on human rights after Brexit, still on Fantasy Island. And that's on Thursday, the 8th of December. So without further ado, Professor Möllers, the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you very much for having me here. It's a great pleasure to talk to you. And there are many reasons to apologize for talking in advance, but I really have to apologize for the title, I'm afraid, because no one really knows what acratic means, and I basically know it, but there's even a word for it in Germany. It works totally different. So when you translate it, you create a lot of misunderstanding. So a crisis is weakness of the will, and acratic is somehow with a weak will. And the idea is actually the general thesis behind the whole talk, is to say, okay, when we look at the European Union and we try to make sense of its state at the moment and its crises, and we look for some kind of description of that, one take might be to say there is something like a democratic acrisia actually going on, which means there is not a problem of democratic legitimacy as such, so we cannot really say, you know, what is going on doesn't really have a majoritarian backing. But what we see is actually that democratic majorities within member states opt for certain kinds of policies, but deny the very implications these policies might have. So they say, you know, we are for something, we are probably for open borders on a certain range, but we don't buy into the implication this has, the necessary implication that has. So that what we see is neither, in a way, the autonomy of the EU as such getting independent from democratic decisions, but what we rather see is, on the one hand, within member states, a democratic process that makes decisions that lead to implications that are not then democratically, that don't have the backing of a democratic majority on the one hand. And what we see on the other hand, and which is kind of usual but important too, is obviously member state conflicts. So the democratic acrisia within the EU between member states, in which democratic majorities in different member states have different ideas of what the EU should be or should do. So what is this up against, this idea to say, okay, how can we, what would be good analysis of the State of the Union? And good analysis would to say, you know, within the member state and between member states, we have something going on that has democratic legitimacy, but the way this democratic legitimacy is expressed, or the way its preferences are formulated, is in itself problematic or self-contradictory. So what would that be up against? Now, I think one interpretation I want to try to refute tonight is actually an interpretation that is very much favored by one of the speakers you had last week, I think, at the LSE, which is Wolfgang Strick, a German sociologist, and no one looks at his, listen to that talk, doesn't ring a bell, fine with me, but who's just one of many, not only German lawyers or sociologists or political scientists, who take the problem of the United European Union to be this kind of growing autonomy of the supranational organs. So basically this idea that the Commission, the ECB, and the Court of Justice of the European Union, what we now refer to as the ECJ in the old-fashioned manner, are basically making up their own agenda, defining it, and they're somehow departing from what could be, you see, could be conceived of as an democratic Europe. So this idea of, you know, autonomy of the EU, as different from democratic legitimate member state union, as an explanation for what is actually going on, or has been going on for the last 20 years at least within the EU, seems to me refutable. A good reference for that opinion, other good references, would be Antoine Vaucher's recent book, Democratizing Europe. I think the Democratize l'Europe has been translated into English now, which basically has the same thesis to say, you know, what we see when we look at the EU is basically our institutions that somehow have lost contact to the democratic process within the member states and to the democratic procedures within the member states. The more general point I would like to make, or the two more general points I would like to make, are first of all to, in a way, have a plea for reflections when we refer to the European Union. So what do we actually mean when we talk about the European Union? Is it far from clear what we mean? Do we mean a concrete organ of the supranational kind? Do we mean the majority of the member states? Do we mean the consensus between the member states that somehow seems to have evaporated? Or what do we mean instead of this? So I think this is some of the ambiguities of the debate we're actually having at the moment that has to be made explicit and somehow has to be cleared up before we can really talk about the State of the Union. The second plea my talk will contain, at least implicitly, is to make clear that when we agree upon the fact that the European Union is in crisis, and basically everybody seems to agree about that, you know, the EU is in crisis, and no doubt about this, that if we agree about that, that doesn't by no means mean that we agree about, you know, what, not even why, which the causes for this crisis, this is obviously quite contested as such, but we do not even agree upon the question of what is the crisis, so in which, what is constituting the crisis? So is the crisis really constituted by the fact that the European Union integration something is stalled? So are we disappointed? Would we like to have the European Union to be something more, something like a social union, something like, you know, more welfareist kind of institution? Or are we, to the opposite, disappointed by something like an integration overstretch? You know, is the EU just too much at the moment, and do we wish it to be less? The very idea that you can, in a way, make sense of this notion of a crisis of the European Union while not really agreeing upon the question in what constitutes this crisis seems to me a little bit silly. So you know, you have somehow to add what you think the crisis is all about to give any meaning to the very notion of crisis itself. And I think this will be one of the issues I will address in my talk. So this is quite an eclectic talk, I must admit that. So I'm a constitutional comparative European lawyer. I think, when we talk about crisis and we somehow try to make sense of what is going on within the European Union, we have to be somewhat transdisciplinary, and that means we have to be dilettantes in a way too, because there is a lot, you know, there are questions of political economy playing in, there are questions of positive black letter law, there are questions of normative political theory, so how do we actually evaluate what is going on, and there are also always some kind of political preferences with regard to what would be, you know, the right thing to come out of, you know, Europe as in general, or the European Union, a little bit more specific. Now, My program for this evening will be proceed in three steps. I want the first step will be to have a look at some of the EU's institutions and somehow to refute this storyline about, you know, the autonomy of supranational organs. There is a considerable degree of autonomy, to be sure, but it does not really fit in the narrative of the ongoing crisis of the European Union, it seems to me. Then secondly, I want to say something about two exemplary crises, the migration crisis on the one hand and the debt crisis, or let's be more specific, the Greek crisis, and wonder about, you know, where is the problem of democratic legitimacy with regard to these crises? Are there really crises that can be described, or don't we have to stick to my own approach that would be what we see here is in a way self-contradictory or conflicting majorities in a way working itself through this problem? And then I will have a short outlook at the end to some say what we could do about this in a more academic manner. Now, obviously, and this would be my first point, the question who is actually in charge of the European Union, the member states or the supranational organs, is the eternal question of European integration theory. So we have been debating that in a way since the beginning, and we have in a way we have vokes of, you know, theory that tells us, you know, in truth the member states are doing this, or in truth, you know, the Commission has become autonomous. My point would be not to give a general answer of that, but just to look at what has happened in the last 10 to 15 years on the one hand, and on the other hand, to have a look at what is actually going on with regard to the crisis. I think as a more general point at the beginning, it is very important to say that when we refer to a deepening of the European integration, when we say, you know, has deepened through, let's say, the Maastricht Treaty or the Lisbon Treaty, there's some fundamental ambiguity in saying that, which says that because when we're talking about deepening, we talk more generally about the fact that the European Union has become more competences, more powers, for example, to have some powers within the field of internal security or foreign politics or whatever. But we don't add up the question of who actually within the European Union is getting these powers. So I think the more general observation would be that at least since Maastricht, so since the early 1990s, the whole development of the treaty law, at least, is a development that very much empowered the member states as intergovernmental as intergovernmental congregation, not as such, but the member states as intergovernmental organization in favor of the European Commission. So what we can see is obviously that there are many new European Union powers, but what we can also see, and this is totally different from having pure member state power, you know, that a member state is in charge of a certain policy on its own. But what we don't have is actually this kind of autonomy going on in which supranational organs that are not directly democratically accountable to member state people are actually doing the work instead of the governments that congregate in, for example, the European Council as an organ that has emerged as a very powerful organ within the last 10 to 15 or even 20 years. So I want to make this a little bit explicit by just walking through the Commission a bit, say something about very, very like shortly about the Commission, about the Court of Justice, and about European Central Bank. And I will give a little paper tomorrow about the Central Bank, so we'll cut it short with regard to the Central Bank. Now, with regard to the Commission, there's no doubt that the Commission is an extremely powerful organization, and there's probably nothing like this within the realm of international government. So we wouldn't know of any secretariat of international organizations or the UN Secretary General, whomever, who has this kind of regulatory and even political powers. But again, it seems to me that we can observe a certain decline of its power even since the early 1990s, not the least being expressed by the very fact that the member states took quite weak personalities being president of the European Commission, so not really expecting anything like agenda setting or political leadership from the European Commission, but rather, in a way, the administration of a certain status quo that entails extremely important powers with regard, for example, to competition law and other fields of economic regulation, but this still being things that had been settled through the Maastricht Treaty and somehow had been consensus had been achieved within the member community of member states. I think this diagnosis is also backed by the fact that we can see a certain decline of the classical rulemaking power. So the classical legislative process, you know, the community method, even by just have a quantitative look at the output. Damien Chalmers actually has done work on that. And what we've seen instead of this is a kind of rise of informal rulemaking by the member states within the European Council that then somehow will be spread over national legal orders and might even be quite effective. What we also see is that the Commission has basically been sidelined with regard to things like the debt crisis. I think the role of the Commission within the debt crisis, and that is a contentious issue, but seemed to me always quite weak when we basically saw a negotiation between member states of all sorts, and the Commission somehow trying to get itself becoming a role as a moderator or something like this, but in a very, very weak sense. And what we also see is that the institutional role, now the crisis has somehow been settled in a way, not really, but at least formally, in a way observing member state budgets and observing, you know, what is actually going on within the member state fiscal policies, is still quite weak. They now have certain powers, they can have a look at the budget, but what we actually observe at the moment is that they seem to be torn between different member state governments and somehow to find a role in compromising. Bending the rules a little bit, but not too much, so that anyone is somehow, you know, the austerity German freaks and the French guys somehow being happy at the same time, but not really as someone who is either really enforcing rules on the one hand or somehow setting a policy agenda to get out of this kind of trap we probably are in at the moment. The Commission is in a very specific trap again, because I think one of its more recent claims, or perhaps more plausible claims, is to become more of a political player. And what we saw with the with Juncker becoming in a way the candidate of the European European People's Party, the conservative kind of party in the European Parliament, was the attempt to say, you know, the president of the Commission will be something like a political justified leader in the future, that is somehow standing for, though very all-encompassing and very general, but political program, and is somehow different from being the head of a technocracy in a technocratic institution. Now, whatever that means, and one has to say that this whole political process had a very asymmetric life in different member states, so there was a big deal in Germany, but I think no one really cared in many other member states for this claim of Juncker's. Even if we take this claim to be true and somehow reinterpreting in the long run, the middle run, the role of the president of the Commission as being someone like a political leader, this might be a problem for his role of being a powerful norm enforcer. Because when we identify him with any meaningful political project, so we could identify him with conservative austerity politics, or rather with left-wing spending politics, you know, this would mean that he is not the credible figure that in a way he has to be to be the guardian of the European rules. I mean, one person who immediately understood this quite early was actually the otherwise infamous German finance minister, who said, you know, okay, Juncker is now political president of the Commission, I take that, so we have probably to shift the role of budgetary controls to another institution. I mean, he said that quite early, and he is a fox in a way. I mean, he understood how he could take the claim, the enlarged claim of the Commission to be a political claim, player, which I in a way do not really, which I would endorse on certain conditions, but how he took it and somehow turned it against the Commission itself. Obviously, behind this whole storyline about the role of the Commission is a more general point, a very difficult point, and a point that's in a way way beyond my competence. And I just want to say something about how to assess this. And the point is a more general point about concerning the question if the EU is something like, you know, a neoliberal deregulator, and if we can say, you know, the role of the Commission as being this kind of autonomous guardian of competition rules, especially, somehow can be identified with the EU, and here especially with the Commission as being the agent of, you know, deregulation. I don't know if this story is true, but I want just to make some methodological caveats to endorse this story, because there's a story that is quite strong in many countries. I think it's strong in parts of the great British intelligentsia. It's quite strong in many circles in Europe, of people who think in European terms, like Fritz Sharp, for example, or Wolfgang Streeck. And I just want to mention what kind of problems I have with that, or what would have to be shown to make that case a little bit more plausible than it seems to me. First, it would have been shown that there's something like a common standard of regulation within different member states. Because what always seems to me is that this argument is very much built around a system that is already heavily regulated. I'm not against regulation, but I say, you know, to take, like, say, Germany of 1975 as the normal state of regulations, and then to take the EU to be a deregulator might be, you know, an assessment that is just quite biased for a very specific form of member state economy and member state legal system. The second thing that had to be evaluated, seems to me, is had to be taken into account is actually a broader scope of what actually we take to be regulation and where relevant regulation lies. Obviously, we have some fields like the field of privatization and of public services in which the European Union was quite relevant. Though one has to say, the relevance looked quite different in England, for example, and in Germany. So one has really to check where to attribute this relevance to the European Union itself, where to attribute it to a spillover of, you know, privatization enthusiasm that goes way beyond what is actually part of the European regulatory agenda. The other thing is that we have to look at regulatory fields that are not very often mentioned by, especially by people who are critical of the social agenda of the European Union. Things like, for example, environmental law. I mean, there are many member states for which environmental law was basically invented through the European Union. And environmental law does not really fit the idea of, you know, deregulation. The same is true for parts of consumer protection law, for example, in Germany, which was explicitly quite weak field in German contract law, and so on and so forth. So the case is not so much to have say they are not, you know, strong liberalizing elements within the EU, and it's obviously the case that the Commission is the player who somehow tries to act that out, but rather to see that this overall assessment of the EU and the overall assessment of the role of the Commission within that is very hard to tell, because we do not only have different policies, but we also have different bottom lines for what is actually regulation or deregulation in different member states. And this I don't know all the research, but this I've rarely seen in the debates we have led with, let's say, at least not across different policy areas. Now, the second culprit is the Court of Justice to the European Union, the ECJ or CJEU, as it is called. Again, there's a strong story to be told about the CJEU being endorsing European rules, not really annihilating European rules for lack of legislative powers, to be in a way stricter to member state law than to European law, and so on and so forth, that many of you might know. Again, the point I want to make is more of a methodological caveat, because it seems to me it is quite difficult to compare the way the European Court of Justice treats the competences of the European Union as put down in the European treaties to the treatment of other federal competence norms by other courts. It's very hard to get a grip on that says, you know, oh, the ECJ is actually much more lenient or much more liberal with the European Unions than the early United States Supreme Court was with actually the federal constitution, or the German Constitutional Court has been by reviewing federal powers in contrast to state powers within the German federal system. It is very hard to get a grip on that. And if you do it, I think you have to take against certain institutional variables into account. First, I think you have to take into account that the ECJ is a Supreme Court. It's not a constitutional court. It's a Supreme Court, comparable to the early German Reichsgericht. You don't want to know that. Comparable to the United States Supreme Court and other Supreme Courts. And the central role of this kind of court is obviously the unity of the legal order within the Federation. and no role is actually in that case. It's the, always the same history in Germany, in the United States, in Switzerland, or in, is that my phone? I'm afraid, yes. Or in Europe. The same story is always that the idea of, you know, setting rules that in a way redefine the federal level, in contrast to defining rules or enforced rules that, in a way, keep the union together and limit the state level or the sub-level. So setting rules for the federal level is always the second step. It's always something that happens way later or much later. So the ECJ was never designed to be a constitutional court of the European organs. And it was never designed, actually, to really seriously enforce a competence order, as we know it now in the German case, with regard to the European organs itself. The idea, I think, was quite different. The idea was actually to say, you know, when the member states get their act together, and when they finally find a way to legislate something, okay, then we're fine with this. And then we want somehow to prevent the member states to, you know, obstruct this in any way. But the idea was not to say, you know, we have a kind of neutral rule between member states and the European Union that was then enforced by this kind of constitutional court. You know, no, you might not like this. You may say this is somehow asymmetric. It is explicitly asymmetric, and I think it's meant to be like this. But it's very much the logic of supreme courts in federations that start quite hesitantly and quite lately to reinvent themselves as constitutional courts. This does not mean that everything the court is doing is in a way plaudible, and that does not mean there is a lot of, you know, usurpation of powers to be observed within the ECJ. The ECJ gets, I think, the most aggressive and the most dubious in the way it reasons when it actually works on, you know, the relation between the not when it treats the member states, you know, as being somehow the main object of the unitary revision of European law, but when it actually addresses external legal orders. So when it has to define itself against the WTO or other international legal orders. So I think the most dramatic step the ECJ had done in the last years was actually opinion, what is that, 213, about the membership of the European Union within the European Convention of Human Rights. That was a dramatic step in that he had something like unanimous opinion of the member states for the EU to enter the European Convention of Human Rights that was basically torn down. By the ECJ. So there's a problem, and that is a problem that can be very easily interpreted from a legal realist point of view as the ECJ somehow defending its own turf and defending, you know, its primary take on the relation between itself and the member states. But again, This is in a way specific in that it does not really address directly the relation between the EU level and the member states on the one hand, and secondly that it is in a way something that follows the same, maybe problematic, but the same logic of somehow keeping the EU a closed legal space and not opening it up to, you know, some kind of other source of authority. There might be a problem, but if there's a problem, it's not a problem that can be, I think, assessed well in this idea of, you know, basically the court getting itself in a biased manner, only addressing member state regulation, not addressing European regulation or something like this. Yeah. Could say a little bit more about that, but let me just mention one thing that is now not sticking to the last 20 years, but about their origins. Many of you know the story about the two famous decisions that in a way founded the European legal order as being in a way autonomous and of direct effect. And again, this is something very untypical for an international legal order. And one might wonder if perhaps the constituent moment of the European legal order somehow was an invention of the ECJ. And is in a way the first witness to the idea that the ECJ is somehow an agent that is problematic. No, there's much to be said about the problem of this, and obviously this was quite a bold step to do for the ECJ. But I think what has to be taken into account when you assess that is the very fact that the European treaties, as early as from their beginning on, were somehow quite different in many terms to normal international treaties, and that especially the preliminary reference procedure that was part of the 177 of the Treaty of Rome, was in a way of interlinking member state courts and the European courts that was in a way unseen, more or less, within international law, and that can be interpreted and was interpreted as an invitation for the European Court of Justice to in a way empower member state courts to get into a discourse and therefore to find solutions that imply something like direct effect. My third very short look will be on the ECB. And again, to cut the story very short, we have a big debate on the ECB and its power and in a way its lack of democratic accountability with regard to the euro room. And there's no denial that the ECB is an extremely powerful, an extremely arcane institution that makes decisions we don't know much about, that in a way address not only the euro states, but whose effects are probably effective way beyond the eurozone and might even be relevant for the United Kingdom, even if it does not remain a member of the European Union. I think for the start, and again, I'm just mentioning caveats of how to think about it instead of giving you clear-cut answers, but I think the first thing that has to be kind of simplistically, but I would like to mention, clear is that there is a difference between general critique of independent central banks on the one hand, there is a problem, there might be a political problem with the independence of central banks in general, and specific problems of the ECB. The fact that the ECB is independent is obviously part of the treaty system. The Germans lobbied very strongly for that, and you might criticize this as a general policy issue, but that doesn't really, that doesn't really count, it seems to me, as a problem that is specific for the European Central Bank. Now, so what is specific? I think what is more specific are two points. First of all, that we still, and we only have anecdotal evidence about this, but that what we still see within the ECB is something like national political preferences being part of the internal deliberations within the ECB. So, when the chairman of the Federal Reserve of Minnesota and the chairman of the Federal Reserve of Connecticut have a problem with each other, it's not really of being from Minnesota and Connecticut. It's mostly probably being about policy issues, about, what is the right way to do monetary politics at the moment on the level of the Federal Reserve in the United States. When the president of the Italian Central Bank, the president of the German Central Bank have an issue within the governing council, that might be different. There's something behind that about ideology, a very German ideology of auto-liberalism, highly problematic, a very Italian, perhaps, ideology of another kind of monetary politics that is somehow clashing, but that has definitely something got to do with the national pedigree of the actors. And that is obviously a problem for consolidated bank. I have no solution for that problem, but it's probably not really well described in terms of, the ECB being autonomous or so. It's in a way perhaps even better described in terms of the ECB being not autonomous enough in, deliberating this kind of problem on a policy level, but still is somehow sticking to the fact that their member state pedigree is still present. The second point would be just to see that the very idea of having a central bank and the president of the central bank seems always only to make sense, and that is obviously a very, very conventional point, but just to be reminded, dependent on the idea of having something like a democratic counter process. You couldn't imagine to think there is a president of the Federal Reserve without having a president of the United States. It's something weird, You can't only have the one without the other today, because even if the Federal Reserve is somehow independent, there must be something like a democratic counter process that is expressing itself, not by giving direct orders also, but to give, the political context for that might be the benevolent or non-benevolent autonomy of a central bank. And this we don't have on the European level. I think what we have is, basically fragmented member state politics that somehow is meeting in the ECOFIN or another arena without really getting to something pan-European. There are many reasons for that, but the decisive point is just that, in a way, again, it's not so much about the autonomy of the supranational organ in that case, but it's about the supranational organ not being contextualized in something other, more democratic and truly European. And that leads, in a way, again, back to my thesis from the outset, saying, you know, what do I mean by acrasia or by acratic union? Obviously, the very fact that when the European Central Banking System was designed, there was a vivid interest in having a common currency without having a common political project. And that's very simply, totally non-original, a very nice example for what I mean by acratic behavior of democratic majorities. Now, let me come now to my second and a shorter point, and let's have a short look at two crises and the question of how we really can evaluate them with regard to my little concept and to the question of democratic legitimacy. Obviously, the notion of crisis itself is a problematic project, because in a way, to say something is in crisis is a highly normative claim. You know, something may get wrong, or you know, you don't like it, but that it is a crisis is somehow something you have to settle upon. And it's interesting to see that we don't always do that, and if we do, we don't have the same wording for the crisis. So, is it a debt crisis, or is it a, you know, banking crisis? Is it a migration crisis? And Jan put me on that. Is it a migration or refugee crisis? Two really different things, one has to say, and so on and so forth. So, even the diagnosis of being in crisis is something we should perhaps more explicit. And I think it's fair to say that the general dissatisfaction we see in very many member states with the EU might not be caused by the EU itself. I don't want to be too apologetic about the problems the EU have, you know, the technocracy, all these things. But when we see how, when we observe the general dissatisfaction with democratic procedures in countries that are not member of the European Union, and we see how, you know, the European Union as an institution somehow seems to invite a certain institutional fatigue and a certain kind of, you know, institutional critique, and especially one that is somehow perhaps driven by nationalism, then we might become quite careful to say, you know, people are in a way against the European Union because the European Union is like it is. That might be the case, but we have to make this case, and it is not by no means self-evident, because we have now a culture of, you know, political unrest, political dissatisfaction with institutions in general that is probably not caused by the European Union, because it is just in very many other states that have nothing got to do with the European Union itself. I think we have to make this caveat. Otherwise, you're just buying into nothing against criticizing the European Union. There are many levels you can criticize it on, but to take the kind of, you know, dissatisfaction with the political system that is so current at the moment everywhere to be, you know, a criterion for a problem of the EU, someone is missing the link. There has to be another argument to make that, because as such, it's not. It's might be plausible in some cases, but it's not really, you know, necessary connection. There's no necessary connection between them. Now, I think the migration crisis is a very nice point about what I call, in a way, democratic acrasia within member states. What we actually can see is in different member states, different majoritarian preferences for different forms of politics that somehow become self-contradictory. You know, you can see the German way of doing was basically, in a way, forget about the problem as long as we cannot see it, because that was basically done. So the German government has for 10 years or more promoted a migration and refugee politics that somehow put the problem to the periphery. So, you know, somewhere, you know, people are dying in the Mediterranean seas, but we don't see it. You know, if, you know, 500 people a week would have died in the Alps, you know, 10 kilometers from the German border, policy would have been different. Good question, but somehow it had been invisible. And I think one of the problems of the European polity, actually, one of the real problems of the European polity as it is constructed, is the problem that, in a way, through the architecture, especially of executive federalism, through this idea that, in a way, rules are made on a level and executed on another level, it's very easy to, in a way, make certain political problems invisible, to somehow make the attribution and the political responsibility unclear or even totally only open to experts. And the migration crisis is a good example for that. You know, we can say basically Germans felt as if the border between Germany and Austria was the German border, state border. But as a matter of fact and as a matter of law, actually the German state border has shifted to the Mediterranean Sea. That is the border where, in a way, the decisions are made. That is the relevant transgression from one legal space to another legal space. But this could be, in a way, kept out of the political process, and therefore people could be happy that the Italians and Greece basically take care of the problem. The very moment this collapsed in the summer 2015, we got a totally different majoritarian framework. And was, I think, it's fair to say it was majoritarian. There was no humanitarian majority. Very, in a way, very weird for all the other member states, and very German for many reasons. But still, it was there, and this was saying we have to take care. They are all refugees. We don't draw a distinction between migrants and refugees. They are all welcome. Please come in, and then we take care of you. And this held, like for 4 months, I guess, and then again flipped again. And what we are now having now, in a certain sense, is we're getting back to the old regime. We're basically getting back to now with some variants with regard to Turkey, if that will hold, and so on. But we now again will have a regime, a migration regime, and a refugee regime in which the problems are pushed to the periphery, which is to Italy and Greece, and Greece is basically collapsing under it. Now, the problem, there's much to be said about that, and the same could be said about Britain with regard, obviously, to free movement of labor and to open borders and to, in a way, even opting out for, deadlines that could have, pushed migration from the Eastern European states to a later point in time and so on and so forth. So basically, the British government opted for a lot of intra-European integration, then I somehow got fed up with it, and then saw the migration crisis in 2015, the government, but the Brexit movement, saw the migration crisis as somehow, an argument, though no one of these migrants actually ever arrived here, or very few of them actually somehow were allowed to enter this island here. So my point here would be to say this is very much a crisis that can be very well described by, majoritarian shift, the shift of majoritarian preferences. And therefore we can hate it, or we can, say that it is an immoral or whatever, and it is probably, but it's probably not undemocratic. might the problem even be deeper than it is, but we have to respect that what we have here is, in a way, conflict of interests of democratic states that is not really taken care of institutionally, and that leads to this kind of strange shifts within the policy preference of the states and within the policy preference of the European Union. But the European Union, in a way, didn't really exist as an autonomous entity within this crisis. It seems to me quite... The Greece crisis would be another point in case in which we don't have actually an internal contradictions within the majoritarian framework, but where we just have the classical good old conflict between member states. Because I have to say that as a German at the LSE, which has at least a leftist history, I don't know if it has a leftist past, I'm not endorsing austerity politics. So I think it's totally wrong. I think the whole German framework is really bad and highly problematic, and we will have to pay the price for that, and already paying it in a way. But I must say that this framework is democratically endorsed. There's nothing about, deparliamentarization or, the troika or whatever. When I look at what actually happened with the Greek crisis, what I see is a firm parliamentary majority in the German parliament negating any more means for the Greece than absolutely necessary not to, have everything broke down and everyone starve. A German government that is, in a way, backed by this majoritarian claim making politics, and the infamous troika basically executing that without having a serious policy agenda of its own. So this whole storyline about, technocratic authoritarianism, which is interesting, and there are interesting examples for that in constitutional history, I think, even in Germany too, but it's probably not really a story that can be well applied to what was going on within the Greek crisis. To the opposite, one can say that the institutional framework, especially the fact that the EU doesn't have any relevant tax power of its own, to raise money that could have been used to solve the Greek crisis, is actually one of the problems that, in a way, gives some kind of formal legitimacy to what was actually going on the German level. Because as long as you have a formal structure in which the rise of tax money is actually national, it is very very hard to make more than a moral point. There is a strong moral point, but more than a moral point, a constitutional point, or a really hard political point to say, there is a general obligation to let's say be more generous from let's say Dutch or Greek or Dutch or German or Austrian governments with Greece or other states. I don't endorse this policy. I think it's quite stupid, actually, and as a matter of clever politics, the Germans should have opted otherwise. But this is in a way an opinion, and I think one should be very careful to identify this kind of opinion with any democratic claims whatsoever. Now, what does that mean? Well, that means that we should be very careful to define what is going on at the moment by any means as a lack of democratic legitimacy of what is called the European Union or of its member state, but instead should have a look at actually the contradiction intra and inter contradictions between democratic majoritarian preferences within the member states and on the European level. And this leads me to the very end of the talk, and just make four short points. So, diagnosis would be what we have is conflicting intention within democratic majorities. So we have something like perplex interests within and between democratic member states, and we don't have really institutional means to solve them at the moment. I think that is quite obvious. What we don't have is neither lack of democratic legitimacy in this sense, nor even a lack of parliamentary power, I think. There's a strong tradition, some colleagues from the LSE have written about that too, to say, there's now the rise of the executive, and you see all these people in smoke-filled rooms, they're not any longer smoke-filled, unfortunately, them having this kind of arcane negotiations, the ECB guys, the government, German finance minister, and so on and so forth. But one must say, under the conditions of parliamentary government, in which basically foreign politics is done by the government with the backing of a political majority, this seems to be quite normal. And it would be a problem if we could actually observe something like re-contradictions. What we actually can observe is, on the member state levels, a very high variety of parliamentarisms in which some parliaments are more involved than others in the actually policy-making and decision-making process of the governmental level. And what we can see in Germany, which is in this case maybe of interest, is that due to claims of the German parliament and due to some decisions of the German constitutional court, the German parliament is very much involved in this decision-making process, but in a way that makes the parliament itself feel a bit uneasy, because they see that they're somehow getting into their institutional capacities, and they don't really want to know everything about, Greek pensions or so. But somehow they don't even, and by no means they want to be responsible for Greek pensions, politically. But they want somehow to have a general frame of reference, and the frame of reference would be, we somehow have a policy measure that is, let no collapse, but not more than necessary for, that member states that are indeed dead. So there's even not something like a deparliamentarization in that. That means, and that would be my third point, we should not really hope for any kind of institution, a more general point, of institutional engineering to get all these problems away. These are problems that have somehow been politically negotiated, but as we especially European studies have this kind of strange tradition of, reinventing new forms of governance and da-da-da, and somehow, trying to avoid political conflicts by, basically administrative procedures, more or less. And I think there's no hope for that here. What we see is, in a way, is this double layer of conflicts within democratic procedures, which we cannot really help by designing new institutions. And that means also, and that is perhaps a little bit more directed at the German discourse than at the British or at the more general, is that we somehow try to avoid to moralize the whole thing in either direction. This Habermasian moral obligation to be a European and to somehow endorse European centralization, or this kind of, German methodological or normative nationalism to say, there's only democracy on a national state level. We are already so intertwined that I think there is no general answer to that. So there is probably no democratic obligation to be either for or against, European institutions, but there might be something like an academic obligation to enlighten trade-offs between different democratic preferences and to respect majoritarian preferences, but in a way to inform them of the very implications they might have. Thank you very much.
That was terrific. Thank you so much. That's fantastic. Really very clear light on what can be a very woolly area. We kind of throw out democratic problems with the crisis. So, no, thank you for really some very thought-provoking remarks there, Christoph. So, to respond for 10, 15 minutes, we have Dr. Jan Komárek of our very own LSE Law Department, one of our specialists in European constitutional and public law, and also the European Institute. So, Jan, over to you. I'm going to start here.
Thank you, and thank you, Christoph, for this wonderful paper. I think I will begin with trying to somewhat peg what you were presenting to us, and it seems to me that it was a very German paper in the sense that it responded to a very particular kind of critique of the European Union, which indeed focuses very much on the rising autonomy of the supranational institutions. And there, I think you are absolutely right in really relativizing this kind of critique and showing that neither of the supranational institutions is as autonomous as this kind of critique suggests. But then I think there is an elephant in the room which remains, and that's obviously the Council of Europe and the member states. And it seems to me that this kind of critique of the European Union, which really starts with, and I don't know if you make this assumption, but it seems to me at places that you somewhat accepted this assumption that the democratic legitimacy or any sort of legitimacy of the state is uncontested, and as long as we can find some links of legitimacy to the state, then we are fine. But what if the problem with the European Union is precisely that it allows the states, or rather their governments, to govern their societies in a way which would otherwise be rejected by those societies, and it's only because those governments can govern through the structures which were instituted by the European Union that those societies had for a long time had to accept this kind of governance over them. And a nice illustration to me was a description of what was going on or what is still going on in the context of the refugee crisis. And you said that Germans could neglect the problem for a very long time because, you know, as long as you don't see the problem, then you don't need to solve it. And in fact, in many respects, the EU enables this kind of blaring problems or not really making visible to people who is accountable for what, that in the end, we end up with a system where it's very difficult to say who is in charge, who is in fact taking the decisions for the people, and how we can change the course of politics we may reject. But at the end, you always end up with the argument that, well, it's in the European Union and it was somewhat decided. Now, I don't think that this is the kind of approach you want to take to the European Union. So my comments, questions to you would be, if we want to see the European Union in a more positive sense, then what that positive sense for the European Union could possibly be. And there, different narratives are offering ourselves. So one would be that it is a system for managing interdependence among the member states. So we simply live on this place of Earth in Europe, and we have borders with each other, and we need to do trade with each other, and we need to engage in relationships with each other. So the European Union is perhaps the best of the systems we may have to manage this kind of interdependence. And I know that there are people who are defending this kind of narrative for the European Union. But again, I think it blurs the fact that many of these interdependencies are in fact created by the European integration. So in fact, the European integration is not a solution to the problem of existing interdependence, but rather it's a source of interdependence. And again, the refugee crisis is a very good example of that, and the monetary union as well, because without the European Union, and then of course political economists will disagree because they would say that monetary union is necessary for the internal market, and without the monetary union you in the long run can't have a functional internal market. But with the refugee crisis, once you create this borderless area of Europe, then of course the refugees or immigrants, then again it very much depends on how we want to see them. Many of them, I think, are not really refugees, but would be really immigrants. They don't want to stay in Greece or in other countries of the European Union. What they want is to get to Germany and other rich countries where they think that they may prosper. And in fact, by having this borderless area, you made everybody dependent on other, where If you don't have this borderless area, this kind of problem would not arise, or would be perhaps arising in a different way. So that's one way of seeing the European Union as a system to manage the interdependencies of the European Union. But there I would stress that we need to be aware of the fact that the European integration also creates lots of these interdependencies. And then another response to seeing the European Union as a sort of a club of the member states which come together and then they try to negotiate their interests and they come up with a common solution which is in a way good for everybody, is to look at who really takes those decisions in the European Union. And there is this obvious critique of the present state of the European Union, which is very much a German European Union, and whether another possible purpose for the European Union, which would not be so much managing interdependence, but rather to prevent domination. And at present, we see Germany as the country which could be made the target of this kind of critique, but in the past it could be other countries as well. And to what extent we should be happy if we are able to somewhat find links of democratic legitimacy to the states, if in fact many states have simply to abide with what other member states who have more power in the context of this new intergovernmentalism exercise, and they simply have to follow what those more powerful states are deciding for them. Now, there was a point in the paper which I would want to contest, and that's perhaps a more specific critique of the European Union, and that's this deregulatory bias and Wolfgang Streck's critique and other German social democrats. And you said that, well, we should look at the consequences of the decisions of the European Court of Justice and the kind of policies the European Union is adopting. And I think perhaps the problem is to distinguish better what kind of policies the European Union disables. And we need to distinguish between regulations, deregulations, and the examples you mentioned, the environment and possibly also consumer protection. That's regulatory policies, but they don't require positive redistribution through fiscal means. And then many of the policies which Streck is talking about, or Sharps is talking about, are the kind of policies which require this kind of fiscal transfers, which are arguably possible only within closed borders. So they require closed entities, and the case law of the Court of Justice, which prohibits any kind of discrimination and closing the borders against foreigners who are not entitled to the same kind of solidarity which would be exercised in the context of the nation state, then disables this kind of redistributory policies, as much as also targeting institutions which traditionally would be responsible, or at least protecting this kind of redistributory policies, such as labor unions and the infamous cases Viking and Laval. But I think ultimately, and that's where I think I would end with my comments, and that's a sort of really a perhaps, at least to me, the biggest question of today's Europe and European integration. And that's not so much as you said, it's not about institutional tinkering and trying to find a better system of governance, but perhaps to identify the question to which the European Union can find response to. And ironically, I found inspiration in the campaign of Brexiteers here in the UK. And there I would distinguish between two kinds of nationalism, if I may say, and one is more perhaps respectable and decent, and that's the kind of nationalism which claims we want to take back control. And it does not necessarily mean that we Brits, excluding everybody other, now want to take control over our country, but it's simply we want to live in a government where we feel that we can exercise our political freedom, if I would use this kind of ideal. And that's very different from a different type of what I would call a predatory kind of nationalism, which says we want to make America great again, because that's about the nation, we are great again. And that's nothing which I would see in Europe today, that nobody, you know, suggests that we want to be great again, but it's much more about taking back control. Now, I'm very skeptical, of course, of the claims made by those who supported Brexit that they can take back control through coming back to nationalist policies and trying to take away, to get away from the European Union. But perhaps it could be a good motivation for the European Union to establish structures where people can feel again that they are having control.
Very much. You brought us nicely back into some very big current issues there. So thanks so much for that. Christoph, do you want to respond briefly before we go to the floor? If there's something you wanted to pick up on.
Was just three sentences. Maybe it's German, I don't know. Yeah, maybe I found some being endorsed by Vaucher's text, actually. And some I think that this idea of the neoliberal you, at least, is something you find in the English-speaking literature, too. Two points. But the final one is about interdependence and hegemony. I think we're on the same page to say, you know, in a way the EU produces interdependence. And my point would to be people who want interdependence, but they don't want the implications of interdependence. So in a way, they want a degree of interdependence that then, in a way, needs the creation of stronger supranational organs, or let's say stronger democratic procedures on the European level, and something more generally European, but this they don't want. And then they have this contradiction, and this contradiction in a way is taking against the EU, whatever the EU in this context then means. So I would say that is something, but on the other hand, there is a deep ambivalence, I must say, and I don't say that as someone who is endorsing German politics, but there's an ambivalence that when you opt for interdependence, even if it is somehow well organized on institutional level, the danger of hegemony is always somehow there. You can just see that in many federal systems, not in all, not in the American, but very much in the German or in the Spanish, perhaps, that there might be, you know, the closer you get, the more the difference between the states become relevant again. And obviously, for every Scot, you know, that might be a subject too, you know. So, and I think there is just a dialectic you have to take care of. That I cannot really solve that. My last point would be, I am not really sold on this narrative about social distributive politics, you know. In a way, the welfare state needs closed borders, basically. That is what these people really see quite strictly. I don't have the political economics to really. I don't know enough about it. But what you see is, for example, you don't see a decline in German welfare politics. Well, it's very contested, you know. You have more spending, but perhaps you have more persons who get it. What does that mean? And it's very much a contested issue, but it's not as if you could say through the euro or through the common market, you know, there is really a degree. There is a problem with the symbolism of it and how that works in Germany with regard to insurance and welfare, but I think the very money that somehow arrives, it's far from clear that this has decreased, actually.
Thank you. So we have time for some questions and comments now. So we have a mic at the back. So if you can just raise your hand, and if you could identify yourself before you ask your question, that would be great. So who would like to? Yes, down at the front. Thank you.
Thank you so much for this impressive talk. Thank you both. Got two questions, really. The first one is, what's the view on intellectual property rights within the frame of the EU, which you haven't touched on? And the second question is, don't you think the whole crisis issue is actually more trying to deal with the harmonization of meeting a common agenda within a pan-European framework? Thank you.
Yeah, I think I would agree to the second point, and I think it's in a way, I mean, if you look at the history of federations, you know, in a way, crisis had to become. This idea of the Commission will be basically integrating incrementally for centuries, and then we are done without any real political fallout. It was just always totally naive and unpolitical and unhistorical at the time. So, and it's quite clear, I think, that with the Treaty of Maastricht, there's an amazing, I'm a crazy German professor, there's a major logic to that, in that, you know, the EU more and more shows up as someone who is not only distributing rights, but in a way abridging rights, you know, as an actor on with regard to things like policy and policing and other issues. So I think it's, and then we have to see that the crisis is in a way quite old, because, you know, even the Maastricht Treaty, I don't know how much, 50.8% of the French were for the Maastricht Treaty. It was quite narrow, actually. You know, there were, I think, less people for Maastricht than people for Brexit. Today, you know, in France, in the 90s. So you have to be very careful of, you know, see that there is something like a state of stagnation and crisis which has been going on for a while. So which is about what is actually the pan-European project and how can we pursue it. And now maybe a better interpretation than saying this is, it would be to say we have this kind of crisis now for a while, since Maastricht. And this is now in a way, how you say that, topped by the general crisis of democratic institutions that is there anywhere, anyhow, and not only in Europe. And this is in a way a very dangerous mixture we have now. We don't have any clue about, you know, the future of the European integration, and we have this kind of, this general dissatisfaction with democratic institutions everywhere. And I don't know anything about property rights international.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yeah, in the middle. There you go.
Yes, cheers. I have 2 points to make. The first one regarding the two case studies you mentioned, the refugee and the debt crisis. I mean, regarding the refugee crisis, I agree with you that there is definitely a conflict between parliamentary majorities and is not a problem at the EU level. Regarding the debt crisis, it's harder for me to believe that. Maybe I've read too many papers from Varoufakis and Stiglitz on the Troika. And I mean, I still think that the bailout terms were imposed from the IMF, so nothing to do with the democratic accountability from nation states. And regarding the regulator versus the regulator dichotomy in the EU, I think the EU has acted as both a regulator and a deregulator, but at different times. So at the beginning, it's true that you talked about the environmental issues, and the EU was definitely a huge regulator and had a huge impact on the development of environmental policy. But lately, I mean, with the whole issue of the transatlantic partnership, I mean, probably it has acted more as a deregulator than a regulator. Yeah.
Man, it's interesting. I think it's very hard. I know some of these papers, and I'm always having a hard time to find a criterion. So what is relevant political influence and what is not? Obviously, you know, the technical terms of that were not made in the federal ministry in Germany or in the Netherlands or by ECOFIN or so. But then again, you know, the basic political bottom line, that what you would normally decide in parliament, I think, which was very much done by those states who in a way could afford it. And therefore, I cannot really see neither this kind of bailout nor even the OMT of the ECB to take another without endorsement of the German government. I think it's totally impossible. And then you can say, okay, the details. Obviously, these are not nitty-gritty details. This is, in a way, the life of people in Greece. You know, the pensions, the, you know, medical distribution of, you know, whatever. We have many statistics of what was going on there. And I think from a Greek perspective, it's totally clear that these are existential decisions made by how the terms are defined, and this means by the Troika. But I think from a more constitutionalist point of view, I try to take here, and getting used to what is a kind of normal standard Western liberal democratic constitutionalist division of labor between parliaments and executives. I think this is a division of labor that we normally see where the political decision is very much a member state decision, and the kind of implementation, though it is so existential, is done by these institutions. And this is a little bit overseen, it seems to me, by this kind of analysis, which is done by economists. The second point, yeah. I agree with you with international trade, and Jan referred to this well-known double game that in a way you, things you cannot do internally you do externally, and so that is probably true for the Commission in implementing policies through international trade, and it has the competence in international trade. The member state gave it to us, not, you know, it's not an usurpation or so, they have it. But I think on the other hand, one has to say beyond that, which is a special, very important, special case, where are really the Commission's policy proposals that in a way beyond privatization of public services really in a way change the, you know, the way things are done in member states in the last 10, 15 years? You know, look at something like a Bolkestein directive and how it somehow got lost in space. And even with regard to trade union power and the decision, you know, when you look at when you look at how that was implemented, it's far from clear. And I don't want to be apologetic about it, but it's hard to see. So, you know, where really the effects on trade unions, which are actually pretty much on the rise in Germany at the moment, can be, in Germany at least, can be seen. So maybe it is the case, but I'm not really convinced. And I don't see really in countries like France or Germany, like classical continental European in a way state-centered societies, this kind of really disturbing effects of the welfare system done by European policies in the last 15 to 20 years. I'm not going to talk about the euro, what it means, but that is a different issue.
Jill,
thank
you. Yeah. Hi, Jill. Just there in the middle.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your talk. You will have heard that we had the Brexit decision in the High Court a week ago. And afterwards, a local politician, Suzanne Evans from UKIP, said that, she said a sentence which received quite a bit of media attention. She said that judges should be independent, but they should also be subject to democratic control. And it struck me that that tension between democratic legitimacy and independence is also a theme that ran through your talk. And so the lawmaking institutions in the European Union are legitimate, Council and Parliament. And then you have the Commission, which is autonomous and independent and is, you know, the European body. And my question is, how should this tension be resolved? Can you enhance democratic legitimacy without losing any of the independence, which is vital, I think, for institutions like the Commission and domestically courts?
Well, I think it's an easy case for courts, you know, to say courts should be independent, bottom line. And I think the problem of the, and if you look at the ECJ, the real problem of the ECJ is not the dependence on any external players like the member states or other supranational organs, but it's actually the external internal constitution of the ECJ. So it's very much presidentialized, and they have, you know, policy processes from within and package deals and so on, which in a way, you know, they have their own little political process going on internally. And that makes them, in a very weird way, it's like with the ECB, but they might be independent, but they have something going on that doesn't really live up to this idea of, you know, deliberative deliberation within this kind of institution. So I think, therefore, it's quite easy, and you could even easily help that. You know, it's quite easy to reform courts, I must say that.
I was thinking of the institution that you were speaking about, like the ECB and the Commission.
But the Commission, you know, the Commission is a hybrid. The Commission started in a way as the deluxe version of the Secretariat of the International Organization, with already special powers, obviously, that were kind of unusual. And it's now somehow, and then always aspire to become something like, parts of it, not all of it. Obviously, parts of it always aspire to become the European government at the end, something like a parliamentary government, more or less, you know. And I think, what does it mean to solve the tension in that case? I think you have to make a decision about what kind of European constitutional setup you want. And the more you want a constitutional setup in which the genuine European level is a level that has its own political life and its own political claim and dignity, the more you want something like a politicized European Commission, and then autonomy is not the issue, but then it's parliamentary responsibility in a more political sense than it is at the moment. The less you want that, the less you think of the European Commission as being the, basically, you know, in charge for the European, what is the sentence, the treaty, you know, for the common good of the European Union, and being somehow a neutral enforcer. And the split obviously runs through the Commission itself at the moment, in a way, because, yeah, you know, we probably, the competition DGs has a different idea maybe than the Juncker has. And I wouldn't, there is, you should never solve tensions. Tensions are a good thing, actually. You should actually just look at what is your idea of European democracy, and is it a democracy of member states? You scale it back, and if you're not, you parliamentarize it.
Can I massively abuse Chair's privilege just for a second? So, I mean, I think it's very compelling, Christoph, how you identify these challenges, that these supranational institutions aren't as in control as we think they are. But so from a functionalist perspective, so I do financial regulation. So what do we do? So, you look at the ECB, and you mentioned supervision in your paper, and it's doing technocratic stuff around, for example, non-performing loans. But that is going to have distributive consequences down at member state level. So if I'm reading this properly, we can't use the lever of democratic legitimization being a problem to kind of get at the ECB. So do we sort of wait until the political process catches up and ECOFIN comes to some agreed sense of what we do about bank loans and where the losses fall? I mean, is it sort of hopeless, if you know what I mean, in terms of fixing these overly powerful institutions?
I think it is, in a way, yes. I mean, hopeless is a strong word, but I think there is no thing, as long as there is no real democratic, there's no real common democratic feeling that this has to be solved on a very fundamental level, I don't think there is. That's what I said, meant by, we're somewhere beyond institutional engineering now. Mm. I think there could be much more said about the ECB. There is obviously a difference between monetary politics and banking supervision, for example. And I think this should be sorted out, probably, and so on. But still, as long as we think that an independent central bank is the right instrument for monetary politics, long I think the independent central bank itself is not the real problem.
So sorry for butting in there. Anybody else have a question or a comment? Yeah, Niamh, over there. So down to the... Thank you.
Thank you. So I'm just going to pick up on something that Jan had mentioned in his comments, which was sort of maybe about the relative nature of democracy at the member state level. And you spoke a lot about the sort of power of the, I guess, the German parliament and decision making in Germany, which I think is very compelling. If you have the money, you get to be the decision maker. But I come from a member state, Ireland, which has comparatively less power in terms of translating its democratic decisions about the EU into policy making within the EU. We learned in the UK this year that referendums are the most sort of visceral form of democracy. We had two in Ireland, and we were told that we'd voted the wrong way and to go back and think about it. And so I'm just wondering, if in public international law, sovereign states are all equal, but some are more equal than others, what does that mean in terms of the nature of democracy in the EU? And if it's a gradated sort of concept, is that really democracy?
Well, obviously, first of all, I think there is always, I think, a price to be paid for federalism in the widest sense, in that you want to be in a community of communities, and the community of political community of political communities, and this creates asymmetries with regard to different memberships in different polities. So obviously, maybe you fare better in a bigger state. On the other hand, you must say, I'm just 180 millionth of the German people. You have a much greater share in influencing Irish politics in a certain way, and I don't mean that it's not pity, actually. I think that somehow works. And the other thing I think is that if that is true, and it is true, and I think there is a problem with the externalities that we cannot really solve, then there might be a democratic point for smaller member states to push European integration. And say we have to push that at a point where the hegemony of the Germany, for example, is somewhat better taken care of by, let's say, an institutional structure that is on the European level, more better lives up to our idea of a democratic thing. The problem seems to me that there are these layers. When you are in a small state and you are a nationalist. Like this is the Hungarian case, Okay, then you somehow stuck with the structure, and you're only you probably the only choice you have, which is rational, is to somehow wind down the whole project and to get out of it again. Which is, I must say, I don't like it, but which is in a way as a democratic case fair enough. So I think there is no real meter rule of how to organize a democratic majority, and there's a very simple point why that is. Because in a way, when you're always a member of different communities, you're members of a local community, of a region, of a state, of a European one, and actually, but you have not all the people identify the same communities as the relevant for them. Some people are really first Europeans and then Germans, and some are really first Florentines and then Italians, you know. And therefore, there no majority rule applies in a meaningful manner. And that makes it always very fuzzy to even identify democratic societies, because, you know, it's very much dependent on what is your definitive community. To say this is an externality and that is actually what I want as self-determination. And therefore, I think my only answer would be, why shouldn't we enlighten smaller member states somehow fight and bigger member states by pushing for integration?
I'm conscious Christoph has been taking questions for a while, but have we any final comments or questions? Yes, over here. Yeah. And two, yeah.
Thank you. I want to pick up from a point that Jan made before, that perhaps we should think of the EU as an organization through which the member states have been, or the governments of the member states have been capable of governing their own states in a way that might not otherwise have been accepted. And if we check that point, I think it's very important that we do introduce some kind of differentiation between constitutional law and sociology right now with regard to the question of legitimacy. Mm-hmm. Because I think you might be right that these decisions are authorized by states, but they might not enjoy any kind of substantial legitimacy from a sociological point of view in the states. And this is why we are seeing the rise of the radical right in all of Europe. So I was just wondering your thoughts on that. Thank you.
Yeah. I have a hard time to take the rise of the radical right, to attribute it like this. I must really say that, because I think we see the rise of the radical right everywhere. And we don't only see it where the EU is actually doing stuff. And we see it in countries, in, you know, we see it in Germany, though Germany is basically allegedly running the show. And we see it in countries where the show is not run by. So I'm not so sure about that. You know, if the European Union had a total symmetric effect on the member states, and there wouldn't be any hegemon, and if there were no right-wing rise outside the EU, this would be a plausible argument. So I'm really not so sure about that. And I must just say, you know, look at the US, or look at India, or look at wherever, and you see this kind of cultural, you know, thick community nationalist discourse rising without supranational institutions. This does not mean that the EU isn't a problem. There are massive problems with the EU. But I would be very careful. With regard to the sociology, yes, I mean, the one question is, I think you have a fair point, you have a very important point, though I'm always a bit skeptical about, you know, formal authority and true legitimacy on the one hand, as if there were any assessment of, you know, collective endorsement that could somehow work without any form of formalization. Or some empirical snapshot would be, you know, the truth, while the other one is just, you know, an empty process. It's very hard to say that. So the question would be, where are cases or where examples actually where something has been shoved through the throat of an actual majority via this idea there is a force to do something? And I think there are examples for that. I wouldn't deny that. You know, you can make this case with regard to, I guess, for example, privatization of public services in some countries. Though, again, I have to say that it looks different member states. Privatization of public services is just quite different in London and in Munich, actually, you know. And somehow you have to see this, too, when you tell this story. One interesting case is actually, I think, the euro, and the case if the Germans were ever really for the abolishment of the D-mark. And I think then you get a plethora of answers. You can say, okay, there were actually polls done during the very moment when it was abolished, where many people were against it. It was kind of borderline. But then again, in the next elections, it was none of an issue. is what, you know, the federal elections of 1994 were not about the abolishment of the euro. No, what was the 94? 2000 and, so when did it actually end? 2002 at the federal election. So no one really talked about the, no one talked about the euro. What do we make out of this? You know, is the one the truth, the other one is not? I'm not so sure about that. And therefore it's a hard thing, but there are examples for that, but I don't see this as actually to be a standard procedure. I don't see really the politics that are done basically, you know, circumvention of democratic procedures within a member state through, you know, kind of the force of the European Union to have to do that now. There are examples for that, but I don't see them as the normal way of how European politics is done. There are too few examples that would come to my mind, actually.
I think the last word is going to go in the front. Yeah, where's our mic?
Right, thank you very much. My question isn't really thought through. I admit this at the outset. And in addition, I also don't have an answer to it myself. So it's a genuine question. But both you and Jan, I mean, you mostly relied on an institutional analysis of legitimacy. Jan had a sociological question, but I think ultimately, even behind an institutional analysis, is also some sociological assumption about the legitimacy of these institutions. And so we tend, when we have this sociological perspective, to think about legitimacy in sort of a gradual sense, that it goes from sort of on the one side sort of complete disapproval, and then gradually towards approval. But we now witness actually a situation where this gradual increase or sort of distribution of legitimacy seems no longer to be true. And we in fact have in many societies, certainly here, just a complete polarization between people who think that the system is either completely legitimate or it's completely non-legitimate, right? Jan mentioned the Brexit case. He said, well, you know, the majority wanted to take back control. It was 52%, 48% actually didn't want to take back control, right? So in a situation where you don't just have this gradual legitimacy, but you actually have always a situation where a substantial, near, close to majority thinks that whatever you do is illegitimate. Yeah. How do you solve this?
That's a good point to add.
Great question, yeah. Well, you know, for constitutionalists, there's obviously an easy answer, and some are hoping that there are some counter-majoritarian institutions that in a way guarantee not that the majority is wrong, but that the minority can remains to be able to become a majority later on. But I must say that is a very optimistic answer, and what we actually see is that, you know, the people's enemies, what we actually see is that the counter-majoritarian institution in itself are somehow only work when there is something like a common ground within the society. So there is no rule of law. So basically, rule of law is a political concept. So if there is no political, at least a kind of minimum political consensus about the rule of law in itself, the rule of law will not in a way won't survive. You know, in New York, I had one of these like 5,000 crying comments on the Trump vote. In the New Yorker, one of them by David Remnick, she had a very decent, nice quote by George Orwell about, I think, what is the protest in the park or something? It's an article Orwell wrote in London in the late 1940s, saying, you know, basically the rule of law only works when majority of people believes in it. Otherwise, forget about it. And basically, when you have a majority of policemen endorsing the Front National, as you have it at the moment in France, well, we are in deep trouble. And there's, I think, no other answer. I think what we actually, that is a very political answer now. The best thing we can do is to lose our illusions about that. As you know, especially as liberals, we should not believe that there is something like a self-empowering mechanism of morals or law or progress or the facts, you know. And there's only a political base we have to fight for. And when we win with the fight, you know, the courts can come back again.
Christoph, I think that is a wonderful way to finish, slightly daunting and chastening, but I mean, I think after the last hour and a half, we have done a lot, or you have done a lot of thinking about this, and we have the tools about how to address these really, really big questions. I can't remember a time, actually, when thinking about what the EU is, what do we mean by its institutions, what do we mean by legitimacy in this context, has been so important. Yeah, and thank you so much for really insightful and most helpful comments, and in particular, thanks to our audience. Really lively debate for Monday evening, which I think is a testament as well to our speakers. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.